The 2019 US Open is done. Rafael Nadal and Bianca Andreescu are champs, and we can safely say the Grand Slam season finished with a bang. But with 4 months to go until the 2020 Aussie Open, we have some time to talk about the biggest storylines from this year's thriller at Flushing Meadows. So that's what's on tap for today. The biggest storylines following the 2019 US Open. Let's begin with the two players that rose their stock higher than anyone else. On the men's side, Daniil Medvedev. On the women's side, now champion, Bianca Andreescu. So let's start with Andreescu. She beats the greatest champion of her generation, Serena Williams, pretty convincingly in two sets. It was a thrilling match. It was a coming out party, really, for Andreescu, who all tournament had showed that she has the ability as well as the tactical maturity to go up with the best in the women's field. And I think going forward, she still has something to prove on the grass and clay surfaces, but on hard courts, she's shown that even at 19 years old, she belongs in that upper echelon of players, along with Serena, along with Simona Halep, along with Ashley Barty. We'll get to the youth revolution in a minute, but all that needs to be said about Andreescu is she's the real deal, and she, along with Naomi Osaka, have shown incredible ability as well as maturity for their age, especially Andreescu at 19 years old. This was a tremendous accomplishment for her. She's going to be around for a long time, I think that's safe to say. And I think that she will be a champion at Flushing Meadows again. Let's go to Daniil Medvedev, a young gun who fell short in his quest to defeat one of the greatest champions of a generation, one of the greatest champions of all time in Rafael Nadal. And if you were to just turn off the TV after that second set, when Rafa went up 2-0, you would say, you know, Medvedev, he's talented, but is he at that level mentally where he can compete with the big three? Anyone who watched the third, fourth, and fifth sets, you realize, wow, not only Medvedev has the level of physical ability to compete, but just like Rafa says, in order to win a major, in order to win the big tournaments, you have to suffer. And Daniil Medvedev suffered. He nearly completed the comeback of the century, it would have been. And even though he came up just short, it really shows you that he also will be around for a long time. He's 23, which in previous eras of tennis, you would say, oh, you should be hitting your prime at around 23. We have to understand, in this era of tennis, only two men, Medvedev being one of them, has even taken a set from Rafa that are under 30, taken a set in a championship of a major. Two men. The rest of them are over 30, so what it really shows you is that it's an old man's game, you can kind of say, in tennis right now, meaning that the veterans, the guys that know how to win, have been around for a long time, they're still running the sport, and you can see it from the men's draw, the type of players on the men's side that made big runs and had success. There were young guys, but Roger Federer, Stan Wawrinka, Gael Monfils, Rafael Nadal, they all made the quarterfinals. Of course, Nadal is champion. It was a great mix of young players and veterans, and what Medvedev showed was that he has the mental fortitude to go up against one of the greatest champions to ever live in Rafael Nadal, go toe-to-toe. And I think it's only a matter of time before we see Medvedev. The questions around him are the same as Andreescu. He's going to have to improve his game on the grass and clay surfaces. But my takeaway is the same. Mentally, physically, he is so close to being on that level that I think fast forward 1 year, Medvedev could be champ at Flushing Meadows. But I also want to say this about Daniil Medvedev. Physically, we can talk about the brilliance of his game. And I know before the tournament, I said there's nothing really that stands out about him. When I said that, I meant more so that he doesn't have a weapon that he can use to great effect against the best players in this tournament. But what he showed in reality was that actually what that means is everything in his game is a weapon that can be used against the best players in this tournament. And he, big serving. Second serves. I mean, the number of... He had several second serve aces against Rafael Nadal. Of course, he beat Novak earlier this hard court season by using first serves as his second serves. So he's got a huge service game. Both his forehand and his backhand can be used to devastating effect. His comeback against Rafa was energized by the fact that he was hitting winners off of his backhand, which was absolutely tremendous to watch. His net game is phenomenal. He made leaps and bounds just in this tournament. In terms of his net game, he started to serve and volley. He's got a great drop shot. What he showed was that he doesn't have the Delpo forehand. He doesn't have the Isner serve, you know, something like that, the Berrettini forehand, which we'll get to. But he does have everything. He's the complete package. And that's just physically. Mentally, we need to talk about this. He looked like he was going to be the heel, quote unquote, of the men's draw after his interview, and I believe it was the third round, and all of his antics and the fines, and that was a huge storyline. But at the end of the day, he puts on a legendary match, certainly the match of the tournament against Rafa, and he comes out and says, look, I'm just human, I made a mistake, and now he acknowledges what he did and that he can be a better person, and it should not be lost on anybody that he won over a New York crowd. A New York crowd. This is an incredible accomplishment from him. Just from his play on the court, he made millions of tennis fans all over the world respect him. Going from abusing a ball boy and flipping off the fans and abusing a ref and all of these things to being the underdog, the guy who's fighting the big champion, Rafael Nadal, who's one of the most popular players of all time. In that third and fourth sets, you could hear the fans were behind Medvedev. They wanted him to get back in the match. It was absolutely incredible. He deserves every bit of praise that he's getting and that he's going to get. And any bit of criticism that myself or anyone levied against him, I think he pretty thoroughly proved us wrong. The only thing that you can say about Daniil Medvedev is that his run actually to the finals, certainly will not say it was easy, but in terms of the number of seeded players that he had to play, the number of top 50 players, it was not on the exact same level as someone like Berrettini or Dimitrov. That's certainly not to take away from anything he did, just something to keep an eye on, to say this guy is clearly an incredible player. He's now the number 4 player in the world, well deserved, and if he continues to stay that high, he will get, I don't want to say again easier, but he will get more straightforward roads to the finals, but we still have to see him prove himself, just like any other young player. We have to see him prove himself against more top 25 players. I think he can do it personally, so to me that's not an issue. Let's switch gears slightly to the next-gen players, both on the men's and the women's side, because there's a lot to talk about here with both of them. I want to stick with these two things. There's so many storylines in the entire U.S. Open, but the two young stars that distinguish themselves, and then the next-gen stars on both the men's and the women's side, to me, was by far the biggest story of the entire U.S. Open, and I really want to spend some time with it. Let's start with the men's side. In the semifinals, there were three guys under 30, three guys making their major semifinal debut, along with Rafael Nadal, who's been here dozens of times. Daniil Medvedev, of course, makes the final. Grigor Dimitrov, who coming into this tournament was an afterthought. His game was so disjointed. He had hired a new coach. He was basically starting from scratch. And the commentators in the U.S. Open, the reporters, they talked about it all the time, that he, throughout the hard court season, he was losing, and it was by design, because he was breaking down his game piece by piece and then rebuilding it with the help of his coach, Andre Agassi, and several of his other coaches. And it was so taxing mentally on him. But he comes into the U.S. Open and just everything clicks, and his quarterfinal win in 5 sets over Roger Federer really showed what that means, that his game can click. He's improved his fitness. His forehand is much better. His backhand is far more consistent. He's got a much bigger serve. I think what it shows is that mentally, more so than physically, he was up to the task against the greatest champion of all time in Roger Federer. And for everything that he's gone through, getting down to, well, now he's number 25 in the world, but I believe this season he was as low as number 80. Getting down to that level, but then mentally building yourself back up to compete against the biggest, loudest crowd in all of tennis at Arthur Ashe, like he did against Roger Federer. To me, it's so admirable what he did, and I hope that he can stay, because he's a lot of fun. He really is a lot of fun to watch. You know, his game, just everything about him, what he does. He's a little too old, I guess, to be called quote-unquote next gen, like some of these other players that we're going to talk about, but he hasn't hit his prime yet, I think, is what we should take from this. On the other side, you have the man who lost to Rafael Nadal in a pretty straightforward, straight set match in the semis, but a guy who, to me, showed more than the rest of the next-gen players, including Daniil Medvedev, despite the fact everything that I just said about Medvedev is all true. But he came in at number 5 into this tournament. We knew that he had the ability. We just needed to see that next level, which we did. From Berrettini, we needed to see both that he had the ability and that he had the mental fortitude to compete with the great players. He showed us both of those things. Coming in at number 24 into this tournament, he showed us that he has everything that he needs to become a great player. That match against Gaël Monfils coming into the men's final was the match of the tournament, certainly. Not necessarily in terms of level of play. Both players made some errors. There was some tactical decisions that were a little questionable. Just in terms of the raw emotion of the match, the up and downs, the crazy points, because you're talking about Gaël Monfils, the greatest athlete on tour right now, outside of probably Rafa. Berrettini, to me, he's like the opposite of Daniil Medvedev coming in. Mentally, I think we knew and still know where he's at. He's very calm demeanor, doesn't show very much emotion on the court. He showed that against Roger Federer, who put a beat down on him at Wimbledon, but he really stayed level and cool-headed the whole match. He did the same against Monfils, did the same against Rafa. That doesn't mean that he's not animated. He's certainly animated, and it's very fun to watch. Kind of reminds me of like Joe Wilfried Tsonga when he was playing a couple years ago and was his own coach. He's animated, but he's still cool emotionally. You know, that it's an important distinction. But what he showed is that his forehand is on par with the best forehands in the game right now. What I love about it, comparing it to someone like Juan Martín Del Potro, is that Del Potro has this long looping swing to get to his forehand. If he connects, it's like the ball's being shot out of a cannon, but it means that if you attack his forehand in the right way, you hit him some deep shots, he may not be able to get full power behind it. Berrettini doesn't have the same velocity, but his swing is so short to the ball, it's such a whipping motion, he can pull it out from anywhere, and what it means is he can hit these outrageous angles, which he did against Monfils time and time and time again. It's incredibly fun to watch. Now, as opposed to Medvedev, he has his distinct weapon, a huge forehand, and he's got a really big serve, but he has his weaknesses. Rafa exploited them. He attacked Berrettini's backhand over and over and over. It's something that Berrettini is going to have to work on, but he showed he has the ability to do that because he hit some backhand winners against Monfils. There are two guys that I became massive fans of this tournament. It was Daniil Medvedev and Matteo Berrettini. Both of these guys are the real deal. Berrettini this year was the first year he played all four majors. He improved his results at each one of them. And to me, at just 22 years old, it shows a lot about his character mentally. I think he has a solid team behind him. He's got a solid chef behind him. We know that at the US Open, at least in New York. These two guys, I fell in love with these guys watching them play in this US Open. I'm not going to go so far as to say that they're going to be the big two and maybe someone else can join them. But I will say that coming into this season, we talked about Zverev, we talked about Shapovalov, we talked about Felix, Nick Kyrgios. Those guys are still in that conversation, certainly. But the two guys that have distinguished themselves over the last 2 months are Daniil Medvedev and Matteo Berrettini. I think that they went from the afterthoughts of that conversation to the forefront of that conversation, and it's certainly remarkable. Let's move over to the women's side. There's more to talk about here just in terms of the variety that we're seeing in terms of the next-gen stars. This was the tournament that proved that the next generation of stars was actually much more ready than we thought they were. Coming into this tournament, we knew that Naomi Osaka, coming in as the number one player, was a huge threat, but getting knocked out in the first round at Wimbledon was a red flag. We knew that Ashley Barty, who's been around for a little while, Serena Williams, of course, great champion, players like Joe Konta, these were big threats coming into this tournament. Simona Halep, who had won majors in the past pretty recently outside of Serena Williams. The next-gen stars seemed like that crop of young players. There was a lot we didn't know about them, how well they would do. I think what we saw on the women's side is exactly what we've become accustomed to seeing watching the women, which is that anything can happen. There's so much depth in the women's game today that we can see players that were afterthoughts coming into this tournament making big runs. That's what makes a women's game really fun these days. But what I love about what happened in this tournament specifically was that I feel like now we have a very clear vision of what the next gen looks like. It's going to be spearheaded by Bianca Andreescu and Naomi Osaka, of course. We know that now. That the next level, which coming into this tournament, there was like 30 players that you could say, you know, they're gonna, you know, be the torchbearers alongside those two players. That next level is starting to thin out a little bit. Not because there are players dropping, but because there are certain players that are distinguishing themselves in that next level. So 22-year-old Belinda Bencic, 21-year-old Aryna Sabalenka, who is the doubles champion now at the US Open, which was pretty amazing to watch. 20-year-old American Sofia Kenin. These are players that are beginning to distinguish themselves in that next level. And I would hope that Amanda Anisimova also moves into that group. She showed she has that ability, but of course, after her father tragically passed away, she couldn't compete in the US Open. So we wish the best to her and a big return to the game. But there is one player that I want to talk about, and it's a player that I'm sure you've noticed I haven't mentioned yet, because to me, it's a very nuanced issue. It's 15-year-old Coco Gauff. Now, you would be forgiven watching the US Open for thinking that Coco Gauff was going to be successful within the next year, and thinking that they're playing her up so much that she's this just outrageous talent, that she had an ability to make a run at this US Open, that she's going to be in the top 20 as soon as the Australian Open next year. I'm saying there is clearly potential in Coco Gauff, but let's temper our expectations a little bit. Coming into this tournament, she had not beaten a top 75 player. Never. Why? Because she's 15. She's 15 years old. She's 4 years younger than the champion of this US Open, who everyone said was an incredible talent because she's so young. We have to remember that Coco Gauff at 15 is just getting into the pro game. There are clear weaknesses in her game. Her second serve is not on the level that it needs to be to compete with any of the top players. It's just not. It would be on the level of competing with juniors players. That's where she should be right now, given her age. Not saying given her ability, but at 15, you should be playing juniors, not in the pros. So what we need to do is look at Coco Gauff and say, hey, in 3-4 years, she has the talent. The second serve will come. She'll get stronger. Her backhand will get better. She'll add more variety to her game. She's already an exceptional net player because of her athleticism. She is unbelievably fast. And her forehand, given the fact that at 15 she hasn't developed a lot of muscle yet, of course, her forehand still has some whip to it. There are so many things to love about her game. But let's remember her age. Let's remember that she's just now getting acquainted with the professional game. Let's slow our expectations a little bit. Let's not put Coco Gauff in that second level of the next generation players on the women's side just yet and say, we'll reserve a spot for you in 3-4 years when you've fully developed into the player that we know or we assume that you're going to become. There's so much to love about Gauff, but not right now. It's more potential-based than some of the other players in that area. That being said, her doubles run, along with fellow young American Catherine McNally, was a lot of fun to watch. They're fun when they play together because their combined age of 32 years old, competing at that level at the US Open, it was fun. It was fun to watch. They're great friends. Their chemistry was clearly there. It's just a lot of fun. But Gauff at 15, McNally at 17, these players are not ready yet to compete with the top level, but they're not supposed to be. I mean, that's not what we have to lower our expectations of these players. If we do that, then next year, when Gauff hopefully makes the Australian Open, if she makes a run to the third, fourth round, and she loses, we won't say, well, that's a disappointment. You know, she was supposed to be in that next level. We say, wow, she's consistently making third, fourth rounds of majors at 15 years old. It's incredible. If we remember that she's at that level in 3 years, we look at Coco Gauff and we say, man, this is going to be an absolutely tremendous player going forward. We just have to be a little patient. That being said, the next level outside of Andreescu and Osaka, who are the only two of those young players that have won majors so far. I'm saying so far, they will come. The next level is extremely exciting when Gauff and McNally enter a field that already includes some of the names that I mentioned before. A lot of them are already ranked in the top 50. And I totally forgot to mention even Diana Yastremska, who's only 19. And, I mean, Madison Keys, let's remember, is only 24. Even Ashley Barty, who's still the number one player in the world as it stands right now, she's 23. She's actually younger than Elena Svitolina, who made a run to the semis and lost to Serena Williams. There are young players here to be really excited about. I don't think we have to lean on players like Serena, players like Simona Halep, Karolina Pliskova to carry the women's division. I think that next level, Osaka, Andreescu, Barty, Bencic, Sabalenka, Kenin, they're ready to take that next step. It makes me really excited for the future of the women's draw. That's it for our US Open recap. We've already gone a little long. There's so much to talk about. There's so much more I would talk about, but I don't want to bore you with it. Tennis is in great hands right now, both on the men's and the women's side, and I'm so excited for the ATP Tour Finals and then, of course, the 2020 Grand Slam season, and you should be too. Thanks for listening to our US Open recap on General Admission Sports. Subscribe for all of our content. We'll see you next time.